All right, we are slowly creeping our way through Ephesians. We are slowly creeping our way through John. And we've been visiting other books along the way. And I just thought that this morning I might want to read the Ephesians 6 verse just so you know where we're at, okay? There you go. And I'm going to read Ephesians 6, 18. And that's because that's where we're setting at. It says, pray at all times in the Spirit with every prayer and request, and stay alert in this with all perseverance and intercession for all the saints. And remember, we're kind of taking in the Spirit. That's the one phrase we're pulling out first before we get into the other things. But today, I'm actually going to be hitting on prayer. And I'm going to attempt, again, with fear and trembling, to go a little deeper in a different phrase that we use in our prayer, not just in the Spirit, but we use in the name of Jesus in our prayers. And I really want to talk about that. So if you go to John 14, where we've kind of been really pulling the messages from according. So we're looking at John in the lens of Ephesians, okay? And then we're going to look today, we're going to look at Mark in the lens of John and in the lens of Ephesians, okay? And we're going to bring these together. But where we're at in John, are we on? Hey, there we go. And the enemy can just lose. Okay. So where I was, where we talked about last week, we began to talk in 14:12. I assure you, the one who believes in me will also do the work that I do. And remember, we went to Esther. We talked about Purim. We talked about Esther doing the work of Jesus. And I don't know about you, but it was just a great visual on how she was doing that. And we studied that out. But we got into the next part that says, so we're going to do the works that he does. And then he says, Jesus says, and he will do even greater works than these. And we kind of sat there, didn't we? Kind of looked at what that was about and kind of looked at that. But now we're going to keep moving on in this. And we're going to take the next phrase, and I'm going to build on last week to get into this week. It says, because I'm going to the Father. Okay, so here's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, look, you will do the work I do. If you're walking in the Spirit, if we're doing what Ephesians is telling us to do, walking in the Spirit, then we will do the works of Jesus. There's no, we might do the works of Jesus. It is, we will do the works of Jesus. And so So that's what it is. And then he says, in matter of fact, you're not just going to do that. You're going to do greater things. And the reason you can do this is because Jesus is going to the Father. And a lot of us look at that and go, well why? Why does he have to do that in order for us to these things to take place? Because God the Father, Abba, knows us. And if Jesus was still here, we would just be following behind Jesus, which is fine, but we would allow him to do the work of the kingdom, and we wouldn't do any of the work ourselves. Because that's what we would do. Isn't that what the disciples did? So he knew he had to go. So his separation, his leaving this and leaving our side, Jesus, is a gift. And it's a responsibility. Because if we swing into the book of Matthew, we realize at the end of it that we are given the great commission to go unto all nations And so we have to do that. In order to do that, we can't rely, I know this sounds weird, but we can't rely on the person of Jesus. Why? We're going to get there because he's promised Holy Spirit. And that's where we rely on. And so this is where we're sitting. We have to, because he left. Now, here's the thing. Because he leaves, the next passage, this is like the connecting between Jesus here talking about the works that we do and even greater works. The because I'm going to the Father is like the connector to the next verse, which says, whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. So we get into the conversation of praying in his name. Isn't that right? Now remember, we're still talking about the missing armor in Ephesians. The armor that we didn't ever really look at as armor. Remember, we talked about the chain mail that fit under that. And we're discovering that that is prayer and Holy Spirit. It's praying in the Spirit. Wow. So, in order for us, I'm more convinced today than ever that without this chainmail, our rest of the armor cannot be effective. Many of us go into battle with loose-fitting armor, with weak armor, and we wonder why God isn't answering our prayers the way we want him to, or come on, we all been there, right? And so then what we do in the church and what we've taught is that, well, all you got to do then is just pray in his name. Just pray in his name. I'm here to tell you something, that it's about time that the church quits using Jesus equally to hocus pocus. You know, when God says, don't take my name in vain, I'm telling you what, if we're praying in the name of Jesus just to invoke a name, I'm going to tell you right now that we are taking his name in vain. And the church is suffering greatly because we are not seeing the things that God wants to do in our lives because we are not doing that. That's very interesting. Onoma is the Greek word for name, and you spell that O-N-O-M-A. Again, I'm doing that for my wife. She's asked me to make sure I spell that out for you guys. You're welcome. Yeah, she's, you know, sometimes the voice of the Holy Spirit sounds like my wife. Onoma. Let me give you this. And in the Hebrew connection to that, it means the exact same thing. And of course, the word onoma means name. But it's deeper than that. It means reputation. It means class. It could mean fame. It could mean the authority of. Oh. Reputation? Class? Fame? Authority? That's what that word means. So culturally, to the people that this was written to, Jesus is in the area of Galilee, so he's speaking to the Jews. So culturally, when he said, pray in the name, what did that mean to them? Well, you have to understand, we say in America that we're family-oriented about things, but we're not. We come from a family, we create a family, and there's this great separation. We may say that's not that way, but culturally, that is how it is. Okay? Culturally, back then, when you got married, you didn't move out. The son didn't move out of the father's insula, his place. They just added on a room. And pretty soon, that became a village. And that village became a town. And that means everybody is probably closely related to you, cousins, second cousins, third cousins. Basically, it was a family reunion every day. Some of us have a really hard time with that. Oh, I couldn't handle that. I'd have to move out. That's the Western culture. So when Jesus says to the people, you pray in my name, they automatically understood what Jesus meant. It wasn't invoking his name. It was saying this. It was saying, not only are we saying in Jesus' name, but we're also saying in his Father's name. And if it was an earthly thing, so if I said something in my name, then it had to do with my dad, my grandpa, my great-grandpa, my great-great-great-grandpa. So not only when Jesus said that, he was saying, you are praying in the name of the whole David line, all the way to Abraham. That's a lot of pressure. Okay, now what does this have to do? How is this? How do we do this? I'm going to tell you what. I guess I'm going to go there first. I was going to do that later, but I think I need to go there now. The thing is that this really means that we're not just to invoke Jesus' name, but we are to be praying, listen to this, in the character of Jesus. That's a big difference. Okay, so how do we play this out? Now, I'm going to tell you what, in some charismatic circles, really just the name of Jesus. Okay? And we sing songs about his name. Matter of fact, right now, one of my favorite songs that's on a Christian radio, which I know some of you know that I don't listen to a lot of Christian radio, but K-Love keeps playing the song over and over and over again, so it may not be my favorite song too long. But, yeah, you know what I'm saying? But it's by Hillsong, imagine that, and it's called Beautiful Name. Oh, that song, man, you better be careful if you're driving on the highway when that song's on and I'm listening to it, because I may be all over the road. Because I don't know what happens when I start worshiping in the car. I check out and I go, oh, I'm in Columbia. Wow, I didn't mean to go here, but I guess I have a divine appointment. So I love it, and it's beautiful because there is power in his name. But it's not just his name, and I think that's where we get it. It is not just power in his name. It is power in the person of Jesus, by the way, who lives in us. So how can we get to the point of saying, I am going to pray in and with the character of Jesus? Now, you may believe, I hate to say this sometimes from the pulpit, but, you know, this is the way it goes. I clearly heard from the Lord this week. Clearly. Like, I mean, I do a lot, but, I mean, this thing rang in my ears. Okay? Rang in my ears. And this is it. Church, the reason that we are not seeing things powerfully in the church connected to prayer is because we are just invoking a name. We are not praying in his character. I want you to know that walking in the Spirit and walking in prayer like this is not about that moment. You see, we get so messed up with that. Yes, should we pray in the moment? Absolutely. But I want you to know that it is not about that moment. It is about the preparation that you have put into it before that moment. So if we're not preparing, how do we expect? Now, let me tell you something. This is a huge thing because, in Matthew chapter 5 or 6, Jesus begins to teach us how to pray, right? And I haven't even got the mark yet. Wow. And he says, and we could all quote it, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be done. And then we get, forgive us our trespasses. I'm doing it in King James again. You know, that's the way I memorized it as a kid, so that's what comes out. I know. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Then he says, and lead us not into temptation. Now here's the deal. What have we just seen? We have just seen putting on the whole armor of God in a single prayer. That is not a prayer that we just say. It is a prayer that we need to walk in. And so when we look at this, we see if we're going to do this, we better be prepared. And being prepared is a hard job because God is going to ask us to do things that we don't like to do. He's going to say stuff like, hey, you know what? It's not about your will, it's about mine. He's going to say things like, hey, you know what? And I love this because we just skip over it. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And thy kingdom come, thy will be done. In other words, it's the gospel message. What is the gospel message? The kingdom of God is at hand right now. The good advice, join this kingdom. Let's get this kingdom rolling. You know? And so we get there and it's like, wow. And then he's going to say, oh, and in order to do this, by the way, and we're praying your will, you're going to need to do some forgiving. And you're going to need to do not just other people. We ask God to forgive us, but really he's saying, Lord, forgive us. And you can look at it this way. Lord, I know you forgive me because isn't he faithful and just to finish what he started in us? But he says, no, you also got to forgive yourself. You can't live in the guilt and the shame. You got to keep moving. You got to keep going. You got to keep walking. You can't get stuck in the past because the past doesn't matter. Oh. Then he says, oh, and the things that you owe to people. Now, we could say money. But that's not it. The things that we've said to people that we regret. Those kind of things. Those things that we do that we regret. Forgive us of those. And you know what, Lord? He's asking us. He's saying, people, will you forgive the things that people owe you? I mean, some people may feel like they've been owed an apology. You don't owe nothing. And then he says, now put on the armor and do some battle. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Deliver us. Redeem us. Be the shield around me. Go before me, Lord. Why? For thine is the, and it says in there, it's added in brackets, which means we're not exactly sure when it was added, but we know that the Lord let us have it, therefore it's important. Oh, that can't, you know, you get all the glory, Lord. For thine is the kingdom and the power. Wow. So as we're praying in his name, and we're seeing this, and we begin to say, okay, you know what? I can't arbitrarily just invoke a name. I have to invoke a character within myself to walk it out. Clearly the Lord said, this is why. Clearly the Lord says, if you're not walking in my character, how dare you use my name? That's a hard message. I mean, I'm telling you what. I was like, are you kidding me, Lord? You want me to, that's a bold thing. How dare you use my name if you are not willing to surrender your everyday life to me so that you can walk in the power of the Spirit? Oh, man. Okay. Whew. I need you to turn to Mark 11, and you're going to go, why are we turning to Mark 11? Because, the Lord had me turn there, and I was like, Lord, I don't understand how this works. And he's like, don't worry, you don't need to understand. Boy, I'll show you. I'll show you. That's how the Lord talks to me, because I can be stubborn. So let me set it up for you. We're not going to read the whole chapter. We're just going to get into the fig tree, the clearing of the temple, and then we're going to get into the Messiah's authority question. But I need to set it up at the beginning, because, matter of fact, we're coming up on this day. We call it the triumphal entry. We've been calling that forever. I call it the sad parade. I call it the sad parade. It's not a triumphal entry. It's a sad parade. And the reason it's a sad parade is because you have to understand the concepts of what was happening in this place. Jesus is now coming into Jerusalem. Understand, he is coming in to lay down his life. He knows it. He's coming into this thing, and now all of a sudden, he gets there, and it's a great miracle. Hey, go to this house. Steal the donkey. If you get caught, tell him, well, the Lord needs it, and you'll be okay. Jesus was playing Monopoly, and he had a get-out-of-jail-free card. That's what it was. You know, again, that must be in the Message Bible. Anyway, so that happens, and then he's writing in. And you got to understand, a different part of a different gospel says that before all this took place, and he was waiting on them, he was looking over into Jerusalem. and he was weeping. And he said, oh, if you would just get it. If you would just surrender to me, like, I would put you under my wings. All that makes me think of in the shadow of the Almighty. In other words, if you would just surrender, you can live. Listen, you can live in my shadow. Oh, man, that's powerful. And so I'm sitting there going, okay. So this is what he's saying in 11. So he gets there, and they get the donkey, and he's riding in. And then all of a sudden, we have the shouts of Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. I've taught on this before. And we all, you know, praise him. No. Hosanna was the zealot's chant for revolution. I was trying to think of a chant for revolution, and the only one I came to was Viva Mexico. Just speaking to my wife's people. But that's really what it was, right? I don't even know why that popped. Oh, I watched a documentary on the place that has no basement. The Alamo, that's it. Okay. Sorry. I had to walk through that beach ball moment. I had to figure out why. Anyway, so... But that was their cry. Remember, the zealot's flag was a palm branch. So when he was walking in, they were laying all these palm branches down, and their coach saying, this is what they were saying, overthrow the Romans, overthrow the Romans, over, and that's what they were saying. And you know who started that chant? We always think it was the people. It was his disciples. Read it close. I'm sure Jesus is bawling even more. This is why I call it the sad parade, because they missed the point. They missed his plan. They missed it all. I mean, Jesus has been very clear to this point. And so that's what's going on. So they walk in the next day. You have to understand, they go into Jerusalem. That's what it is. It's interesting because it talks in this verse that Jesus didn't stay in Jerusalem. He would be there during the day, and then he would exit the city, and he would come back in. We really don't know why, except for maybe there was a safety thing, because the church is trying to kill him. And it's going to get worse. Now, listen. So as this goes in there, it says the next day. So this is after all this takes place. The next day, he's hungry. And you may not think that's a cool verse, but I think it's a great verse. Because Jesus knows what it is to be hungry. Jesus knows what it is to have, and Paul writes this, but I know Jesus does too, so I'm kind of stealing from Paul. He knows what it is to have a little, and he knows, I mean, come on, he came to earth, he knows what it is to have a little, and he knows what it is to have a lot. Why? Because he was sitting at the throne room of his heavenly Father. So he went from the deluxe apartment in the sky to where we're at. So he knows about this, he sees it, he understands it. He says, they came the next day, and they came out from Bethany. He was hungry. And after seeing in the distance a fig tree with leaves. Now, when we read this, we're like, oh, man, there's food. You know what? You have to understand the awesome thing about the fig tree and how the culture thought of the fig tree. There is a sense when it, okay, we don't do that. Well, maybe we do. I don't know. But it's like when you look at how Jesus asked them to do the lampstands and all that. There was always the almond flour. There was that doesn't happen just by circumstance. It wasn't that Jesus said, ooh, that's a pretty flower. Let's use that. It's a good decorating choice. There's always a meaning behind it. In that culture, everything has a meaning. The names have meanings. Where you live have it all has meanings. And the fig tree has a meaning. It always was prosperity and security. Because they have a great long, they give fruit a lot, you know, that always is. And I don't know, I grew up in California, and there are fig trees. And y'all, if you've never tasted a fig that just is pulled from the tree, you are missing some deliciousness. There's something about that that you just eat, and there's a satisfaction. Maybe you women would know, understand that, like chocolate. Guys, we eat about everything, so I don't know what it would be for us. Cheetos. All right, Cheetos. We'll go with Cheetos. But you know, You know, it's funny. My brother-in-law, he has this thing. His favorite thing is to, and I don't even know why I'm hearing this. It's just a thing. His favorite thing is to have a soda or pop. Just to clarify for everybody, I don't know what you call it. Or if you want to double it up, soda pop. Anyway, and a bowl of chips. For him, that is, we've talked about it. He goes, I don't know about you, but that's the most satisfying thing ever. I'm like, okay, I'd rather have a juicy porterhouse, but, you know, whatever. And, but this is what this fig represented. And so he saw that, and security and prosperity and all this. But when he comes to it, it has no fruit. Is it a bad tree? No. It goes on to explain the reason it didn't have any fruit, because it wasn't fig season. It wasn't supposed to have fruit. It wasn't supposed to have fruit. And I'm sitting here looking at this passage of scripture and going, Jesus kind of freaked out. Just being honest. Because he says, he looked at it and he said, may no one ever eat fruit from you again. It's not the tree's fault. The tree is doing the tree's job. It's got leaves. It's preparing to give fruit. But what was Jesus teaching? I believe he was teaching for about what was about ready to happen. He was hoping that if he gave a little spoiler alert to the disciples, that they would get the next series of events. What he was saying is that for that tree, the time has come. It is finished. There is no longer a need for this tree. Hold on to that. What happens next? And I promise I'll tie this all in. What happens next, we find in the next passage. They came to Jerusalem, and he went to the temple complex, because that's what he did every day, by the way, and began to throw out those buying and selling in the temple. He overturned the money changers' table and the chairs for those selling doves, and would not permit anyone to carry goods through the temple complex. Then he began to teach them, it is written, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations, but you have turned it into a den of thieves. Then the chief priests and the scribes heard it and started looking for a way to destroy him, for they were afraid of him because the whole crowd was astonished by his teaching. And whenever evening came, they would go out of the city. When I began to see this and I began to understand, he was trying to say that what was taking place within the temple, its time had come. And it was no longer effective. And there's some reasons for that. We have been taught all of our lives, and I believe this is part of it. I don't believe there's a one thing. You understand what I'm saying? I think what we have here is probably a comedy of errors. But what was taking place, number one, is that they were selling the sacrifices, which was actually not a bad thing. Because think about it, this is coming up to Passover. This is something in which you had to travel to. You were to bring a lamb or whatever your sacrifice was, whatever you could afford, had to be spotless. It had to be a perfect breed of that animal. And if you have to take them 100 miles, there's a good chance by the end of the 100 miles, that lamb is not going to be perfect any longer. So in all actuality, the selling of those things was not a bad deal. But what was really going on is, and it's written in history, is that they were gouging the people. It reminds me of going to get a soda at a ball game. Why did they charge so much? Because they can. Because if you leave, you ain't getting back in. So therefore, if you want something to drink, then you better buy it there. Oh, and by the way, you can't bring anything in from outside. So now they really got you. So they can charge you $10 for a one chip and an ounce of soda. And it's okay because you're a captive audience. Well, that's what was going on. But there was something else going on. If you notice, he said, you've turned this house is supposed to be a house of prayer. It's kind of what we're talking about, right? But to all nations. Okay. The other thing that was taking place is that there was a total separation. If you notice, the temple was supposed to be kind of like, well, actually, I'm a believer that the temple was never supposed to be, actually. And I'll explain that in a minute. Because, see, God had given them a plan for the tabernacle. See, the temple was always supposed to be you talked about the trailer, dude. it was always supposed to travel. It was supposed to be a nomad thing. Why? Because the Jews were given a job, the first great commission. They were to be a light unto the world. They weren't supposed to be stationary. They were supposed to go into all nations so that people would understand who Yahweh is. But the people, just like they wanted a king, you know, the king itself, and I understand, I mean, we kind of did the same thing. We built this place, right? But what we're trying to do is not build this for anything but a tool for God to use. This is just a tool. This building, again, this is not the church. This is a metal building that the church happens to gather in. It's just a tool. It's just a place. To be honest with you, so we don't have to take the trailer everywhere. I mean, let's just be honest. Now, there's some downfalls to that, and there were some downfalls to that. So this is what the people wanted. Now, all of a sudden, you've got to understand, the king, I want to build you a house. Is his motives wrong? No. But as the temple grew, it grew into something that it should have not have been. Now, all of a sudden, we have different courts. We have the court of the Gentiles, the court of the women. We have this place, that place. Only certain people could go in there and here, and only you could access the priest if you were this and that. Oh, it sounds like the modern church. He says, my house. In the tabernacle, there was no courtyard for anybody else. And you say, well, that's because they were just the Jews. No, read the scripture. It says, your whole household, including your male and your female servants, your kids, they all take place. Even if they didn't believe, they still took place. They understood. They were allowed in. And you got to tell me that there were some non-Jewish people. If you follow the story all the way through, remember we even have an Ethiopian later on that said, I want this. I've been reading this because he came. In other words, he already had a recognition of who God was, and he had come for the temple stuff, but now he wants to know more. He had this desire to know more, to go deeper with him, with his relationship, and he wanted to know the word. Because he was reading the book of Isaiah. Man, what a book to start out for your Bible study. That's what he wanted. But what was happening is the nations were no longer allowed to come and pray. They were no longer allowed to have access to the Holy of Holies. Now, I know the Jews didn't go in there, but at least they were in the presence. So Jesus, now I believe this is the second time he cleared the temple. You could debate me on that, but the way Scripture lays it out, to me, there's two events. One, he takes the whip to people. He's a little more. This one is different, and this one comes at the end of his life, where the other one was at the beginning of his life. And again, he's still going, what are you doing to my place? This is my fault. This is Abba's house. And I love how he thought that, even though he knew that it had lost, the temple had lost its templeness. Why? Why? Because God knew that we were becoming the temple of God. We were becoming the Holy of Holies. We were becoming where God dwells. Jesus is teaching, if I am in you and you are in me, then the Father is in you. Oh, and by the way, I'm sending you somebody else that's going to be in you as well. We become this temple. And so he's saying, yeah, stop it. Oh, and that causes a riot, doesn't it? You think you want him dead now. How dare you do this again? This is, and they just didn't want to kill him. I went and looked this up. They wanted to utterly destroy him. So you and I need to quit whining when we come up against persecution. Because we don't know what it is to be utterly destroyed. There's only a few people on this planet that get it. The Jews during World War II. The American Indians, early revolution. How about the Japanese Americans? How about the gay and lesbian lifestyle? Utterly destroyed? We don't want to utterly destroy. The church is set out to do it. The church is set out to say, anybody that's a little different than us, we're going to utterly destroy. That goes against the Great Commission. That goes against what God has called us to do. He has called us to reach out in love, mercy, and grace. Become one new man. To be united with each other because we are made in the image of God. And we are to reach out. We can't even reach out within ourselves. Much less the world. Have we not turned this into, and then he says, and you've not even just, it's not even a prayer for the house or the prayers for the nations anymore. You've turned into a den of thieves. Bad translation. The word thieves, really, the better translation is brigand. If you look at what the Jewish connected word is, it means a band of. Whatever. Okay, listen to this. Brigand, what is that? It is really a it was a zealots. See, what was happening is the church was being used as a staging point to usher in man's kingdom instead of God's kingdom. And I want you to know, church, it has got to stop. It has been going on since the beginning, and it continues today. This is not about what we want. This is not about what we can achieve. This is not about our success. This is not about anything. It is about Jesus being glorified. It is about his name being lifted high. It is about his kingdom being expanded. It is about people understanding the gospel message and joining this kingdom. Have you ever noticed how Jesus prayed? He never invoked his own name. Just saying. So then, we're gonna go again. I'm gonna connect it. Okay. So then, they come out of that temple experience. You talk about a different kind of church service. They come out, and they're walking back towards Bethany. I don't know, if you don't think God has a sense of humor, you're not reading scripture. It says, so early the next morning they were passed by and saw the fig tree withered from the roots up. Now, oh, Peter, the oldest guy, the guy who's seen more life than these other teenagers. I find it interesting that it's him. It's like you're walking. Jesus, that tree you cursed, look, it withered from the roots up. Wow, that's pretty awesome. I find that funny because I go back to the question that we ask, oh, just show us Jesus the way or show us the Father and then we'll know that he didn't. And what was it, Philip, who said, well, just show us the Father. He said, whoa, how long do I have to be with you? I'm wondering if he's looking at Peter going, do you listen to my sermons? Were you on the Sermon on the Mount? Were you there? Oh, maybe you just went to the bathroom during that part. You know, I mean, I this is just how I see it, and I'm like, okay. And Jesus replied to them. Now, this is where we start connecting things. Jesus replied to them, have faith in God. Not believe in God like before, but have faith. In other words, I am going to live my life because God is who God is. I'm not going to change the way I live my life based on whims and based on thoughts and philosophies. I can't. I am going to live my life based on the one who was and is to come. Have faith. And remember, faith is not a word that we just throw around lightly. Faith has legs. Faith says, I'm going to do what I say. I believe. Okay, now let's tie this into prayer. You see where I'm going? All right. I assure you, if anyone says to this mountain, be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes in what he says will happen, it will be done for him. Okay. Jesus, you're getting a little crazy. You're talking about throwing mountains. I don't wear a cape. You know? But you're saying that if I have faith, and I can look at what mountain is he talking to? It could be a lot of mountains, right? It could be a total amount, but let me go to a few little places with you. Maybe it was the Herodian. You see, the Herodian was this huge fort that Herod the Great built. And by the way, there is nobody more brilliant in building than Herod was at his time. I mean, the man had a skill set. He was an architect, and he had the right people working, and it was beautiful. He took a mountain and carved it into he made it. And his fort was on top of it. And you know who grew up in the shadow of that? In a little town called Nazareth? His name was Jesus. So we could look at it and say, maybe he thought about that mountain, get up and move. Or maybe, now for some of us this might be a little more difficult, but maybe he was walking towards Jerusalem and he was seeing the temple mount, Mount Zion. And he was saying, that is not what it was created to be. Maybe that mountain needs to be moved. Not the place. I do believe that there is something inherently special about the land of Israel. I believe that that's part of the covenant that was made. And it in Scripture it says this will be a covenant forever and ever and ever and ever. Now, we don't understand that because we don't get that, but I don't get it either, but I just know for some reason that's where God, I mean, that's where, hey, Revelation tells us, man, 21 and 22, who's going to come and tabernacle with us again? Jesus. And where is he going to come to? That place. So here, maybe he's saying, man, that's got to, but I don't think it was the mountain itself. I got to believe that it was what was happening on that mountain that needed to be thrown into the sea. And church, I wonder if we've got some stuff that we do. This is stuff in our personal lives, stuff in our church lives, definitely stuff in our nation, stuff that we do that the church needs to stop, have a little bit of faith, fall on their knees, and instead of just invoking a name, but we have prepared in order to be in the Spirit, and we say to those things, you get up and move, and you get thrown into the sea, because we are not going to be dominated by this kind of thing any longer. But you notice there he says, hey, if you believe in your heart, remember, heart, not this, not the center of you, the gut. With every fiber of your being. We got to stop right there, because do we believe who God is, who Jesus is, who Holy Spirit is, with every fiber of our being? Because guess what? If we don't, we can't walk in Jesus' character. Do you realize that Jesus never doubted? He never doubted. Oh, yeah, he did. Remember, he was on the cross. Oh, God, why? No, 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 man. He was quoting a psalm. He was singing us. Jesus, in the height of being persecuted, nailed to the cross, was singing a song. Try that, y'all. You read that. Woo! That's a victory psalm, let me tell you. And we got to believe. We got to have faith. So then in this, and then with connection 24, therefore, what therefore? That you believe with everything, with every fiber of your being. Therefore, I tell you, all things you pray for and ask for, believe that you will receive them and you will have them. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, so that the Father in heaven will also forgive you of your wrongdoing. But if you don't forgive, neither will your Father in heaven rejoice or forgive your wrongdoing. Oh man, it sounds to me like he's coming down and he's whipping out the Lord's Prayer again. Do we believe and understand? And have we acted in faith? Acting in faith, to me, is what I'm learning, is that it is being forgiven with the Father, being forgiven with others, working on being forgiven with myself. Because, y'all, that's a hard place to be. Why is that for us? Because we know us. We long to do things we ought not to do. You know? And we know it. Praise the Lord, He has grace and mercy. Praise the Lord that He understands. Praise the Lord that He was hungry and He gets it. I wonder when He saw that fig tree and He was hungry, if He thought, oh, man, if that fig tree had fruit, man, it would remind me of sitting at my table with my Father in His security, in His blessing. You know, maybe it wasn't just because I just feel like He was saying, look, what's going on in the temple has to stop. You see, if we're going to act and walk in His character, if we're going to prepare to do that, man, we have to ask. And there's a scripture that says, Lord, search me and know me and see if there's any wicked way. How do we pray? How do we walk in the character? I'm telling you. I don't know about you, but I want the Lord to forgive me. So the first step in our action of faith is to forgive others. They came again to Jerusalem. This is in verse 27. As he was walking into the temple, and the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders came in. We look at that and we say, "Oh, what?" Well, basically, it was the Jewish governmental system. And asked them, "What authority are you doing this thing? Who gave you this authority to do these things?" Jesus said, and this is again funny, "Well, I'll ask you one question, then answer me, and then if you tell, and then I will tell you by what authority I do these things." And he goes and he asks about John the Baptist. He says, "Was he of God or not?" Now, you had to be careful there, because John the Baptist was one popular dude. And it says in there that they were perplexed, because if they would answer one way, it would cause a riot. Now, they already understand that if one more riot takes place, the Romans were going to come in and just, right? So they had to be careful at this point. But if they said, no, he's not of, you know, there was going to be a riot. And if they say yes, I'll just read it. "If they begin to argue among themselves, if we say from heaven, they will say, then why don't you believe him?" Because Jesus was preaching the same message. John the Baptist was given the gospel message. What was John the Baptist's call? Repent, for the kingdom of God is what? Now, at hand. What was Jesus saying? The kingdom is here. The kingdom is established. And but if we say that he isn't, then the crowd's going to get on to us. So they said, "We don't know." And Jesus said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." I'm going to tell you what, church, when we begin to walk in the character of Jesus and we're preparing every day for the movement of the Holy Spirit to guide us and teach us, if we're doing this, and let me tell you something, it doesn't have to be perfect. Can I get an amen? Because we're going to mess up sometimes. We're going to miss the boat sometimes. We're not going to hear sometimes. Do you know why? That's why we're in community with one another. Because if I don't hear, I believe someone out there does. And maybe your job is to step in for me, or maybe your job is to say, hey, pastor, hey, are you doing what you're supposed to do? Oh, but we don't want that in our lives. We don't even want God to tell us what to do, not less the person across the congregation from us. It's not that they're telling us what to do. They're just trying to speak into us, speak life into us, trying to guide us there. I'm going to tell you, when we begin to do this, what's going to happen is people is going to question the authority in which we do things. And I want us to know that we are under no obligation to give him that answer. You see, praying in the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, is about the preparation. So I need to ask you this question. And band, you can come up, because I'm going to close with this. Have we misused the name of Jesus? You see, if we want our prayer life, I don't know about you, but anybody who follows Jesus and you talk to them, what do I hear from them? Oh, I want to pray more. I know I should pray more, but I don't. How many have been there? I need to be in the Word more, but I don't. I need to be connecting to people more, but I don't. You want to take a step in that direction? If you want to take a step in that direction, begin to prepare your hearts now for tomorrow. In my life right now, there's a mountain. And I've told that mountain to get up and be thrown in the sea. But I've also said, your will be done, not mine. I'm not saying that to pat myself on the back, because this is a journey that I've had to walk. You see, I'm here to tell you that when we walk in the Spirit, there is peace in the shadow of the mountain. Because it may not be God's will for you to say to that mountain, get up and move. It may not be God's will for that giant in your life to be slain at that moment. It might mean that you have a wilderness time. It might mean that you have to walk through something really hard. You have to look at the unknown. You may have to do this, but I'm going to tell you what. When the unknown comes, when the walls of that mountain are in front of us, and I've prayed and we've prayed and we've done the things that we want to do, I'm going to tell you what, I've been convicted about just invoking a name. I have been convicted about saying, Lord, you bring me into your character. And when the Holy Spirit teaches me and he tells me to speak to that mountain, then I will. But until then, I'm going to praise you in the shadow of the mountain. I'm going to praise you in the shadow of the giant. I'm going to praise you in the storm. I'm going to walk on top of the water. I'm not going to sink. I'm going to keep my eyes focused on you. And I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. Even if you slay me, Lord, even if you kill me, I will still praise you, because you are my Father in heaven. Hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us today our trespasses, and forgive us those who trespass against us. Lord, forgive me for what I've done to people and what I owe them, and have them forgive me. Father, please Lead me not into temptation. Put on the armor that you've created for me. Let me walk in it. I'm going to tell you what. I can face the mountains. God may be asking you to put on your climbing gear, and you are to scale the mountain. I'm tired of a church who is weak in their prayers. I'm tired of a church who just says his name but doesn't walk in who he is. When will we wake up? When?